My name is Alex Sikon.
Oh, sorry.
My name is Alex Agant.
My name is Ethan Ma.
And before we begin, we'd also like to acknowledge the two other students that helped us develop this proposal, Zarek Drozda and Manan Shah. They were not able to come with us on the trip. And we'd also like to thank Mr. Eric Nelson because he assisted and he was our advisor in developing the proposal.
Okay, so the title of our presentation is a comparative analysis of feasibility of nuclear disarmament through humanitarian considerations. So what is our project? We're looking to create a successful policy, and we're doing this by looking at humanitarian initiatives in the past. We analyze those humanitarian initiatives and see how they were successful and whether or not successful, and then we try to draw conclusions from those examples from the past and try to bring that to the current nuclear situation. The four humanitarian initiatives that we chose from the past are the abolition of slavery, the ban of chemical weapons, prohibition of landmines, as well as the protection of the ozone layer. So we'll start with the abolition of slavery. We'll be discussing abolition within the confines of Europe and the United States. And even though slavery is still a problem in the world today, we'll just look to the past for now. It started in the Enlightenment ideals of Western Europe during the 16th and 17th centuries. And a lot of leftist groups in the French Revolution were responsible for promoting abolition and making it a viable movement. Eventually, political leaders in Europe caved into the overwhelming public pressure, and this was responsible for abolition in Europe. When it passes in Europe, coincidentally, sugar profitability is in decline, and this is important because in Britain, who had a lot of colonies in the Caribbean, slave labor was used to harvest sugar in the Caribbean. So as slavery became no longer economically viable, we see that it is prohibited. In the United States, slavery is prohibited during the Civil War. It was a strategy by the North, which relied on a heavily urban and industrial economy to injure the South, which was a primarily rural economy. And since the rural economy relies on slave labor, we can see that importance of how an economic disincentive is responsible for the abolition of slavery.
So the second issue we examined was the ban of chemical weapons. Chemical weapons include chlorine gas, mustard gas, and phosgene gas, which is a choking agent. There were two very significant and important agreements that came together. The first was in 1993. The Chemical Weapons Convention prohibited the development, stockpiling, and use of chemical weapons and mandated their destruction. And then again in 1997, the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, also known as OPCW, was established to implement the provisions of the CWC. It was supported by 189 member states, which is approximately 89% of the world, so it was very successful. And it was effective in destroying and dismantling almost 60% of the world's stockpile of chemical weapons. We drew several parallels to the movement to abolish nuclear weapons. Both movements aim to prohibit a specific field of weaponry that is seen as more dangerous and inhumane as conventional methods. And we think that if the chemical weapons movement was able to destroy 60% of chemical weapons, there's no reason that we shouldn't be able to achieve the same degree of success in the realm of nuclear weapons.
Next, I'll be discussing the prohibition of landmines, specifically the Mine Ban Treaty or Ottawa Convention of 1997. A lot of the success in the Mine Ban Treaty was the result of the work of NGOs, specifically the International Campaign to Ban Landmines. They started a system to vote for the Mine Ban Treaty outside of the UN, the United Nations system. It was successful because it implemented a strict time frame for disarmament. States who ratified the treaty were required to completely disarm and destroy their stockpiles within 4 years. There are currently 122 signees, which translates to roughly around 80% of the world. Furthermore, it encourages cooperation globally to promote education in mine-afflicted communities, as well as efforts to demine those areas. Some of the failures is that the treaty is limited only to anti-personnel mines, which are mines that are designed to specifically target humans. This is a failure because many countries can get away with building other mines that are technically not anti-personnel mines, but display many similar characteristics. Furthermore, many of the world powers have not signed this treaty, including China, India, Russia, and the US. Some of the similarities between landmines and nuclear weapons are that they do not discriminate, meaning there are many civilian casualties as a result of both landmines and nuclear weapons. The difference being that nuclear weapons, the destruction is much more on a greater scale and much more rapid.
The next issue we examined was the reduction in the use of ozone in the chemicals. So we're just going to give a bit of background on this issue. There's a small amount of substance known as ozone in the stratosphere, and it protects life on Earth in the lower atmosphere from a specific band of UV radiation known as UVB. When we see a decline in the ozone layer, we see a corresponding increase in the prevalence of cancers such as skin cancer and the death of marine life. So there were, again, two very important treaties that aimed to reduce the use of ozone chemicals, and the first of which was the Vienna Convention for the Protection of the Ozone Layer, and the second was the Montreal Protocol. So both of these treaties were some of the most successful multilateral treaties of all time. They were signed by 47 states and ratified by 197, including the European Union and every member of the United Nations. They were actually the first two treaties in history to be ratified by every member of the United Nations. So the important, the contributing factors to the reduction in the use of the ozone-depleting chemicals was transparency, the development of an alternative coolant called Green Freeze by the humanitarian organization Greenpeace, and a multilateral collective fund that helps developing nations reduce their usage of ozone chemicals. So we set out some specific goals for our policy. We found it necessary to get to the root of why the countries fund nuclear programs. And we decided that there were three primary motivating factors for developing nuclear programs. The first of which is national security, the second, fear, and finally, national pride. And we sought to solve answer the question of how do we solve the fear and national security issue for countries that already possess nuclear weapons, and how do we prevent rogue states from developing nuclear weapons and joining the nuclear capable parties and states. We are doubtful that we can completely eliminate nuclear weapons in the near future. So instead, we're just focusing on taking one step toward disarmament and decreasing the probability and likelihood that a nuclear event is going to occur.
So our plan has three main parts. First is the centralization of nuclear weapons. We wanted to pursue this in order to limit the number of nuclear capable parties. The second part is the research NGO, which seeks to promote nuclear research on a global level, to have cooperation between nations, and to make the information to develop peaceful technologies more widely available. The third is the mining surveillance, which is also an NGO that we propose. It seeks to increase the cost of fissile material, making it, therefore making it more difficult to obtain.
So the second component of our plan is the centralization of nuclear weapons. In our research, we discovered that the actual quantity of nuclear weapons over the past several decades has declined, but the number of nuclear-capable countries, or countries that possess nuclear weapons, has increased. And we believe that that is a more dangerous factor because it makes diplomacy and mediating during conflicts more difficult. So our approach consists of what is going to be a council that shares a lot of similarity with the United Nations Security Council. And it will be headed by the five official nuclear weapon states, which is China, France, Russia, United Kingdom, and the United States. There will be each of these five nuclear weapon states will represent a number of non-nuclear weapon states and their close allies. And so there will be a co-ownership approach to nuclear weapons. And a nuclear launch will require a unanimous vote, and so this really decreases the likelihood of a nuclear event. The goals of this are to give non-nuclear weapon states a greater voice on the world stage and in nuclear affairs, as well as to make a nuclear launch highly improbable and reduce the number of players in the nuclear state.
It's also important that the framework of this organization is solely pertaining to nuclear affairs and not, and will try to refrain from being political or military alliance, because such a web of alliances was one of the results of World War II, and we're hoping to not repeat that. Second, for the research NGO, it researches nuclear surveillance and nuclear defense technologies. And hopefully we can have cooperation within all the countries globally. It will promote peaceful uses of nuclear technology, and hopefully the benefits of the peaceful uses of nuclear technology will outweigh the tremendous cost of pursuing a nuclear weapons program, which does not offer much aid to a country's citizens, whereas nuclear technology does. It also will increase public awareness of nuclear affairs. We saw that in the abolitionist movement, it was important that the public was strongly supporting the end of slavery. And there was a lot of activity within writers and artists to promote this. And the research NGO will also do the same.
In addition, there will be a surveillance agency, which has a similar purpose to the International Atomic Energy Agency. It will monitor nuclear testing and the mining of fissile material, as well as regulate the pricing of fissile material. And this will make fissile material more difficult to obtain, as well as determine prices by the global community to avoid monopoly status. We believe that in its current form, the International Atomic Energy Agency is very inefficient. We saw that during the Fukushima disaster. It took a long time for them to respond. So part of our paper is actually the dissolution of that agency in its current form and this new surveillance agency.
So before we leave, we'd like to leave some parting thoughts. Currently, it's important that we make cautious and careful decisions, as we would not like to make any rash decisions that could lead to a lot of hardship in the future. And we'd like to find more creative solutions to nuclear disarmament and non-proliferation that goes beyond the mutually assured destruction prompted diplomacy that was the driving force of a lot of the Cold War treaties. And finally, can our research be applied to solve global issues on a larger scale, that is a humanitarian approach to many global issues?
Does anybody questions? Oh, wow. Okay.
So I want to say that that was a great presentation, by the way. It's very informative. I'd like to ask, so earlier you said that you're gutful in the belief that we can completely get rid of nuclear weapons. Do you guys have any idea on how we can dispel that belief and build confidence in the idea that we can dispel nuclear weapons?
I think that we meant to say that we can't consider it like one step. We can't just say, oh, let's just eliminate nuclear weapons. I think it's doubtful that we can eliminate nuclear weapons completely in the near future. So this is our way of taking a small step towards disarmament. Because, I mean, again, the conference title is disarmament, not abolition of nuclear weapons. So this is our step towards disarmament. Okay, thank you.
I'd also like to add that under the current situation, believe that nuclear disarmament is very difficult and there are going to have to be a lot of things that go correctly. But in the possible future, as we keep on taking small steps towards that goal, we believe it is possible.
Thank you.
Thank you for this great presentation. I just wanted to ask what prompted you to originally look at historical events for ideas on how to solve this problem at some point?
I guess I'll take this. When we received the prompt for this year's critical issues forum, we just started brainstorming a bunch of ideas, and we had this giant paper with a bunch of just ideas that everyone was putting forth. And we decided it was kind of a spontaneous process in that we just chose. I said I wanted to do landmines. I didn't really know why. I just felt drawn to that movement, and Alex chose.
I think we chose to look at a lot of past issues because we see again and again all these attempts towards disarmament and the abolition of nuclear weapons, they fail. But we've been able to solve these social problems and issues of the same kind of scale or of a large scale. And so we said, you know, how can we solve the nuclear problem? So we went back and tried to learn some lessons.
Thanks so much for that presentation. I just have two really quick questions that I was hoping you could answer. First off, in regard to nuclear proliferation, do you think there's any way to incentivize nuclear weapon states to affect disarmament? And second off, in regard to your nuclear family plan, how do you plan to motivate and push Russia and the U.S. to join this nuclear family when they both have openly said that their reasons for possession of nuclear weapons is to deter the other from using? Thank you.
I guess we're on the same page here because by joining that family, the goal is to deter rogue states or states who have not signed the NPT to pursue nuclear weapons programs because the incentive is just not there. And we believe this is a benefit both to the current nuclear weapon states as well as the non-nuclear weapon states because current nuclear weapon states will not feel threatened that other countries are going to pursue nuclear weapons programs, which we are currently seeing as the case.
And I think our plan does have an economic incentive for dismantling nuclear weapons because the represented countries, the constituents of the five nuclear weapon states, will be able to dismantle their nuclear programs with the confidence that their representative state will represent their interests on the world stage, and so they will no longer have to spend as much on nuclear weapons development and defense. So.
Hi, thank you for the very interesting presentation. I just have one question about your proposal. You said that you propose centralize the nuclear weapons so that the P5 can control them, and each of the P5 will represent some non-nuclear state. But If every country is represented like that, what is the enemy that the nuclear weapons that your proposal says that the people are going to hold fight against? Because I don't see that there's like an enemy that we need to fight against using nuclear missiles. So isn't it better just to disarm them then?
So let me just try to understand your question. You're saying that after creating this council or this nuclear family, there's no reason anymore to possess nuclear weapons, you're saying? And there's no enemy, so...
Well, yes, because there's no enemy, then why have nuclear weapons?
Well, I think there's not necessarily an enemy, but the interests of different states are gonna differ. There's going to be conflicting interests. And so... That's why countries design nuclear weapons in the first place, is to, again, national security, protect themselves. So I don't think it's necessarily like an enemy, but they feel that they do require nuclear weapons to maintain security. I'm sorry, am I answering your question?
Oh, yes. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think that, to add to Alex's point, most countries who own nuclear weapons don't plan to use them or would rather not use them. There would be many terrible consequences if they have them, more as a symbol of protection and to go with the three incentives that we listed, security, pride, and out of fear. And the goal for decentralization is, in effect, to lessen the gap between the nuclear weapon states and the non-nuclear weapon states, because we see that in the NPT there are a lot of double standards and many conflicts, and we're trying to
Yeah, our idea behind the centralization component of the plan is that, for example, with the Cold War, right, you had this massive arms race and escalation between two countries. What if that time, that scale of escalation, that scale of arms race occurred between three or four countries? You would then have to mediate between three or four, maybe completely different ideologies and conflicting interests, while it would be much easier to negotiate just between two countries.
I have another question. We know that right now nuclear disarmament isn't easy, and we probably have some few ideas about why it isn't. But I'm not really sure about. Okay, so I don't really know about what made a ban of landmines and chemical weapons accessible. So can you tell me more about that?
So I'll talk about the landmines. My example, we saw that there was an active effort by many NGOs, and I think the same can be true about the nuclear, current nuclear situation. We see ICANN, which many schools have mentioned in their presentations, as an active participant in trying to raise global awareness and raise global awareness and support for disarmament. The cemetery, the similarities between that I found between the nuclear weapons and landmines are that they are both a set of weapons that humanity has generally considered that we should not use them, because there are certain effects that are more dangerous and more harmful than, I guess, conventional weapons. For landmines, after they are planted during wartime, many in the communities that they are planted, when people who have been relocated during the war move back home, the landmines are still there, and therefore they pose a problem to those people who live in those communities, usually rural and agricultural communities who are heavily reliant on farming as a system of economic support. And when the farmland is no longer viable due to the landmines, this causes a lot of destruction, and it's very destructive to their way of life.
So I think we just run out of time. If you have any more questions, you should have gotten this handout, about 8 or 9 pages with our names on it, and you can just read through that. Hopefully that will answer any of your questions.
Thank you.